My name is Vincent indeed, and for the last 2.5 years, my focus has been on applied IT in the port area. And I want to share my story of working with the Internet of Things and the vision of a digital twin. But first, let me put some things in context, because I work at the Port of Rotterdam Authority. And the Port of Rotterdam Authority has two main responsibilities. One is the sustainable development, management, and operation of the port, which you could basically see as a landlord. The other responsibility is maintaining the safe and smooth handling of all shipping, like traffic planning, traffic management, and safety. And these core tasks we do for the Port of Rotterdam area, which is 12,500 hectares big. It hosts over 3,000 businesses where 180,000 people work. And there's 80 terminals. And each year, 140,000 vessels visit our port, of which 30,000 vessels are seagoing. And all that adds up to an added value of 21 billion euros yearly. So you can say that we have a big impact on the Dutch economy. But we are port, and I want to show you how big we are. And these are the ships that normally visit us. This is a big container ship. It's over 400 meters long and 57 meters wide. It's 10 stories high, so it's about as big as 4 football fields, or soccer for the American listeners. it's as big as a big apartment building. And the trend is that bigger and bigger ships are coming, because they can be more efficient that way. But why are they actually coming to Rotterdam? Well, then we have to go back to the reason that why does a port exist. A port exists is because we connect the sea with the hinterland. A port gives safe and efficient berth and the possibility to transport goods, either loading or unloading. And this is a 24/7 operation with many parties and accessory planning involved. Now, as I just shown you how big the ships are and how big the port area is, being as efficient and safe as possible for this core process is of big impact, because a lot of money is involved, a lot of parties are involved. So you have to imagine that the shipping company can save up to 60,000 euros for a single ship visit if the ship can go out the port an hour earlier, because it saves time and a lot of money. So that is a challenge that we've been handling for decades already. That's what we're good at. But there are some new challenges up ahead that I want to talk about. Well, the first one I'll talk about shortly. It's the energy transition. It's about going from fossil resources to sustainable and renewable resources. And this is very, very important for our port, because right now, over 50% of our industry is carbon related, such as coal industry and oil industry. So going from fossil resources to renewable resources is a big impact to the port. And all I want to say is that we want to be ahead of the competition, not only the competition, but we want to inspire the rest of the world with what we can accomplish here in the port. As I said, I only have limited time, and I want to talk about digitization, which is the other challenge, or maybe even an opportunity for the port. There is going to be change in trading, change in planning, and in decision making through all kinds of innovative new solutions. There's three main influences for the port, I believe, which will either give us new opportunities or bigger challenges. One is 3D printing, the other one is blockchain, And the last one is robotics. And with robotics, you have to think about automated terminals or even the coming of autonomous ships. Well, actually, in the port area, we already have some clients that are pretty far ahead, like this automated terminal. This automated terminal, there's no person working on the facility itself. The vehicles are driving fully autonomous. The smaller cranes are also autonomous. And the bigger cranes are actually remote operated. And what we see now is that when these terminals are running for their full potential, is that they are much safer and much more efficient than the conventional terminals. So if we have an automated terminal, how long will it take before there will be autonomous vessels coming to the port of Rotterdam? I know it is going to be soon, but we have to be ready. I believe that we have to be ready in 2030. You know, there's already autonomous cars driving around and autonomous ships in much easier environments, but the port is very complex. But in 2030, we are ready to host them, to facilitate autonomous ships. But the journey of an autonomous ship will be quite different than that of a normal ship that sail across the ocean right now. Let me show you this. This is a picture of a part of our physical port. And ships come in and ships go. And the ships right now, they have a captain and they communicate with our physical port. They see the waterways, they see the quay walls, they can call our harbor master and ask questions, and they have a pilot on board. But what if a ship is autonomous? Will it still communicate with our physical port? Well, I don't think it will. So in that way, we have to digitize our port, going from the physical port of Rotterdam to the digital port of Rotterdam. So we have to digitize our operation, our assets, and the way we think. And when you think about it, a digital port has no physical boundaries like land, environment, and population that we have to deal with. So maybe a digital port of Rotterdam can grow bigger than the physical port of Rotterdam. And of course, objects in a digital port do not need physical connections to interact and relate. But isn't this what we're trying to build or trying to do? How does that compare to a digital twin? For the port, the digital twin is about the port in four dimensions. It's length, width, height and depth. And that can be of an asset, but also the location of an asset in the port, which is also a 3D aspect. So that works double. And the other one is the fourth dimension, is time. So what is the status of a specific object in our port right now? Or what is the status of a process in our port right now? And that's something we measure with sensors. And then we build up the historical data and can do prediction based on modeling. Basically, we want to start to keep track of the things happening in our port, mostly related to location and time. Like a sensor measurement on a specific location and moment that says something about the environment or object, like measuring wind, water, force, temperature. Or an event happening on a specific location and moment, something like the docking or the undocking of a ship, an inspection, or even a payment in our port. Then we have also journeys from a location in time to another location in time, with important information such as estimated time of arrival, estimated time of departure, other traffic in our port. And in our digital twin, we can also see the project development on a specific location and moment. And things happening in project development can be an investment, a client, a contract, something about the environment. And when we keep track of all of that, we can, of course, start simulating. We can have the digital twin answer very important questions for us as a port, such as what is the most efficient way to manage the port? And how can we ensure that our port is safe and that it never goes down? These are some really high-scale questions or macro-scale questions that we want to simulate and play with. It's about ships and cargo, but also information, money, carbon dioxide, everything that goes in and moves around in our port and goes out of our port. We are actually pretty far now with building the foundations of this digital twin with some key partners. One that focuses on the connectivity and the security of the connectivity, which is Cisco. We have Esri helping us with visualizing and putting everything in a three-dimensional space, so that for the first three dimensions of our digital twin. And then we have IBM, which we use the IoT platform to gather all the information from our port area and put it in the right context, either real-time, historical, or predictive. So when we have this digital twin and it's going to give us answers and we can simulate, what we try to accomplish is zero loss of time, zero loss of cargo, very importantly also zero spill of carbon dioxide and zero safety incidents. And for me, these are the differentiators that separate a really smart port from the rest. Both being attractive for our clients by being fast and efficient, but also remaining safe and with respect to the environment. So this is what we want to accomplish with our digital twin. But how will it look like? Well, now it's getting interesting, because what you see here is just a small percentage of our port area. And inside this port area, there's already thousands of potential digital twins in this picture, like key walls, buildings, plants, vehicles, cranes, engines, etc. And as I said in the beginning, we are just a landlord, so most of these objects are not even ours. And all those objects are still collecting data and sending them over. But can we connect all of them? Do we want all of that information? Or do we need another way to look at it? Well, I believe that we're not going to build a digital twin bottom-up by just digitizing every single object in our port. We're going to make a digital twin from a macro level, from top-down. And how we do that is that we see the port as a single object with moving components inside and around through the three-dimensional time and space. And that were the ships and the vehicles and the goods and the money and the information I was talking about earlier. And when we have the port as a single object, we're going to look at the critical components and the only the essential details for our core processes and connect them. And our responsibility as a port, or a job as a port authority, is also making sure that all our clients in the port can utilize digitization and their own digital twins by facilitating them with the physical and virtual infrastructure they need to connect everything. So how will that look for example, a simple ship visit? I'm just simplifying this to show you how we look at it. For the journey of a ship to our port, we don't need the information of the entire digital twin of a ship. We just need some essential details that is important for us, like the location or the status, the dimensions of a ship. We do not need to know every screw or the type of engine, etc., etc. So what we're doing is just getting the right information, connect them, and make the digital twin for the core processes. It is a start, and that is what we're going to build from. What we do have, however, is for our own assets, we are making digital twins of them too. Like this key wall. This is very interesting because this key wall has a lot of fiber optic network in it that measure forces, measure water levels and temperature. Because when you build a key wall, you build it for 50 years, you build it for a specific purpose. And from asset management perspective, we have to measure those things to predict maintenance, to predict its lifetime, but also to learn how our asset is being used. And we can actually interact with our customers by digitizing this key wall. It can let us know when it's free. It can let the ship know if there's too much pressure on the boulder, if it needs another tow line, for example. Another example for an asset are these dolphins. Yes, they are called dolphins. They're not swimming. They're just standing there. They're pillars. But this is for a ship to berth without using a key wall or a buoy, for example, mainly used for a waiting place for ships or for ship-to-ship transfer. But these dolphins are getting more technically sophisticated every year. We're building new ones. And they need power supplies, and because they're in the water, the power supplies are autonomous. And on these dolphins, there is mechanics that that get the tow lines in and keep them in place. Now, because from an asset management perspective, this is kind of difficult because you have to get a boat to even look at it to see what's wrong. So our asset management department has been digitizing these dolphins so they can see from the office what is wrong, who's using them, and if they need to go there to fix one of them. But the same with the key wall, especially the information about how they're being used and in at what times, by which ships, that is what is interesting. And the same for dolphins, what we can measure is like the berthing speed, like the speed of which ships actually hit our constructions, because these constructions are made based on engineering models from many years ago, and the ships have changed, the environment has changed, and we want to see if the models that were being used for the construction are actually if those models are true to the what is actually happening there. So now we can find out that the ships are actually berthing or hitting the construction slower than we would have thought, which would mean the lifetime of the construction can go up, or we can facilitate bigger ships on these dolphins. So yes, we are making digital twins also from the bottom up, just digitizing specific assets, specific objects in our port. But to make a digital twin of the whole port, we are looking at from the top-down perspective. And as I said, the autonomous vessels will come to our port, and in 2030 we will be ready to host them in Rotterdam. But I think people have to realize that these autonomous ships, they will berth in a digital port first to see if everything is all right, to see if all criteria are met and it's safe to berth, and then they will physically berth in the port of Rotterdam. So the whole decision making will change because of having a digital twin of the port. And this, I want to show just a little bit of the whole picture of what we're doing in the port of Rotterdam. And if you got any questions, feel free to ask me.